Hey everyone, Gabe here. Just a short quick announcement before the episode. I just wanted to say congratulations to Damien and Caitlin from Adventures in Aurelia, who just got married this past weekend. So congratulations. Hope you guys have a wonderful honeymoon and a very happy marriage. Congratulations. Welcome to InterParty Conflict, the podcast where we answer your questions so you can have the best tabletop gaming experience possible. My name is Gabe.
And my name is Jeff.
And we are going to answer your questions today. But first, Jeff, I have a very important question.
Oh?
How are you doing today?
Oh, today?
Not yesterday.
No.
I already know how you were doing yesterday. How are you doing today?
Wait, how do you know that?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Today I am doing, I'm doing pretty good.
Cool.
I am a little worried how excited I am about this, actually. I got a new vacuum today. I'm not joking. I am really pumped about this vacuum.
I can't argue. Anytime I buy something new, I'm always excited about it.
I'm so excited about this vacuum.
Well, I'm very happy for you. Kind of a similar thing. We either need to get a new lawnmower or we need to get our lawnmower fixed. Something was I don't know what the problem was, but for the last few weeks, like whenever we tried to use it, my wife does all the lawn mowing. Whenever she tried to use it, the grass wasn't really going into the bag, and I don't really know what would have caused that. But also, we didn't use it for a little while. It kind of got left out in the rain for 15 minutes yesterday or something. And I guess it was out in the rain the whole time. And we lost the gas cap. I don't know how we lost the gas cap, but it's not there. And neither of us can figure out where it is. Anyway, I put gas in it today. You know, I dumped out just in case there was any water in there. I dumped it out as best as I could, put gas in there, and I couldn't get it to start. And I don't know if it's because some water got in there. I don't know if it's because maybe like the carburetor's flooded or something. I don't know. Or maybe just something else is wrong with it. I don't know. Anyway. But this is not the lawnmower cast or
the vacuum cast. This is cast.
Yes. This is InterParty Conflict. We haven't used the InterParty Conflict ding in a long time. And I was even when we had Luke from the DM layer on. One of the questions we were going to talk about, I specifically chose because I was like, oh, we will be able to say the phrase inter-party conflict in this question. And I didn't say it.
Oh, no.
It was a question about jealousy between players. I mean, come on.
Oh, sure.
Anyway, speaking of guests, though, I want to mention that, I just want to say thank you to Jessica from Incoming Game, the reboot podcast.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. She was on last week. It was a lot of fun to have her on.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah. And it was a great episode. I always love having guests on. And
yeah.
She was a great guest to have.
Yeah. I mean, like, I always have a good time when we have guests on. I know Gabe has a little extra work.
It is more work.
In the editing side of things. But I feel like overall it's a net positive.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I don't want to have guests too often, but we've been having them about every 3 weeks for a while. And we have another guest scheduled in that same, 3 weeks from last week.
Ooh.
So in about 2 weeks. So cool. So keep your ears out. Anyway, so you want to go ahead and get into this episode?
Yeah, let's go.
Okay.
Let's get out of here.
So, Jeff,
yeah.
I want you to imagine you're in combat. There's an evil swordsman that is, evil. He's a misguided swordsman. He's a swordsman with which you have a disagreement. He's swinging a sword at you.
Mm-hmm.
You're dipping and ducking and diving and dodging again out of the way. And you think to yourself, oh, man, there's nothing you can do to beat this guy. He's better than you. But you remember you've got some spells you can use.
Oh.
So you don't remember what it does, but you're like, your sword's coming at you. You're like, I gotta cast this spell. So you quickly chant some words, you move your hands around, whatever. Suddenly you wink out of existence. You have just cast a teleport spell.
Ooh.
However, you didn't specify where you wanted to go. You feel yourself being transported through the astral plane like you do, I guess, when you teleport. And the next thing you know, you're in a dark room.
Oh.
It sounds like it's a bigger, every movement you can hear like echoing around the room. But you you reach into your pocket, you pull out a tinder twig and a torch, and you light up the tinder twig, you light the torch, you hold it up, and then you realize that you made it, you did something good, because you randomly teleported into a room full of gold and rubies and artwork on the walls and magic items piled up as high as the eye can see.
Sweet.
However, you realize you could only cast that teleport spell once. But maybe there's an exit.
Sure.
But until then, you have found yourself in the Dragon's Hoard.
Yay!
All right. Today's Dragon's Hoard item was submitted by Avanshill via email. Thank you, Avanshill. And if you recall, he submitted the Sakura hair clip, I think it was called.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It was like a hair clip that lets you change what your appearance, I think, if I recall.
I think that's
I could
right.
very easily check, but
right.
My hand is just not going towards that mouse. So, but anyway, the item that he has submitted today is the Sakura Blade.
Ooh.
So you may be noticing a bit of a theme.
Sure.
With these. And this one is either a katana or a wakizashi.
Yeah.
And so that is either a longsword or a shortsword in D&D terms. It is rare and requires attunement. To the average passerby, this blade doesn't seem too special, but to the keen eye, the blade seems to emanate a subtle pink energy pulse from the whole blade and almost seems translucent. Ooh. At times. A black blade made from the famed Sakura steel of Hanami's top blacksmith. This weapon has a pink diamond embedded into its handle, serving to contrast its ominous dark metal edge.
Hmm.
This weapon has a single charge that returns at dawn. Once per day, the wielder can use the single charge to cast the spell Misty Step. So if you recall, it's a short-range teleport, I believe. However, with this sword, the silvery mist is replaced with a brief flurry of Sakura petals.
Ooh.
So you use this little teleport, there's a flurry of petals, and you're gone. You're over there.
Ooh.
The wielder may also, as a reaction, teleport as per the spell to avoid an attack it can see coming. The wielder must match or roll higher than the enemy's attack roll with their own attack roll.
Hmm.
On a success, the spell goes off as normal, which creates a brief silhouette of Sakura petals before scattering. But on a failure, the spell fails and the wielder is struck by the enemy.
Mm.
So I think that's the star player of this item here. It is a sword that you can use it to Misty Step once per day, or you could teleport as a reaction.
Yeah.
So when enemies come in to attack you, they swing their sword at you. You have to roll high enough. But if you do, your sword meets their sword. And the moment the two of them touch, you turn into a big pile of Sakura petals or cherry blossom petals, I believe. And then you're gone.
Yeah.
In fact, you're teleported. So you're not even a short range teleport. You could be like miles and miles away.
Right.
Which I think is a little weird. I think maybe it should have been. I don't know. Maybe it should have also been Misty Step or something.
Yeah.
Maybe
it's the other way around where that's the Misty Step. So you're like kind of doing like a little combat dodge or something.
Ooh,
like that.
Maybe.
Yeah. But in any case, it's really cool.
Yeah. It's so cool. I love that you have to roll to mash their attack.
Right. Yeah. So you're like, you're parrying them. And then, yeah, like it is very in the spirit of like, you know, like samurai battles and stuff like that, where they're just like, they sort of like blink, you know, like, where they're like charging at each other and then they suddenly appear like on the other sides of each other and they're not looking at each other and then there's like that slight pause and then a spurt of blood from one of them and they fall over.
Or in one of the Dragon Ball Z movies, I apologize everybody, one of the Dragon Ball Z movies, the Z Fighters or whatever the crap they're called, they're facing three androids. Not the three androids from the show, but the three androids from this specific movie.
Right, yeah,
and they sort of, there's three good guys and three bad guys, and they all kind of like pair off. And there's a point where there's this like big, like gray-skinned android with like a ponytail or something, and like he and Trunks fly at each other. You see him land in the background. Trunks lands in the foreground. He's got his sword out. And you think, oh, man, Trunks did something cool. But then you see, like, blood come down from Trunks' face. And you're like, oh, no, Trunks didn't do good. But then the other guy turns around. And then his, like, top of his body falls off or something.
Right, yeah.
And then there was a similar one. Vegeta flies. The one that Vegeta has teamed up with or has squared off against is this like little tiny, possibly racial stereotype of a blackface person. This little tiny guy. And the two of them fly at each other. And then similarly, Vegeta's in Super Saiyan mode. You see him like punch at him, but then he lands on the ground, falls out of Super Saiyan. So he just got beaten the heck up. But then the other guy starts laughing and then like explodes or something.
Yeah.
So something similar. You think, oh no, the good guy lost, but then the bad guy dies.
Right. Yeah. They went all out and then, you know, passed out, but still did enough damage to defeat the enemy.
Right. Right.
Yeah. That character is very blackface esque. Right. It's not great.
Yeah. That's also the movie where Goku gets punched in the balls.
It is.
I'm putting that in the show notes, just so you all know.
Very much is. There is. You should put up the. There's a team. The Team Four Star abridged version of that movie is pretty funny. But they do that part in like slow motion. It's so good.
Yeah. So anyway, I mean, it's sort of related because this is, you know, Japanese theme. Dragon Ball Z is Japanese, of course. I love the theming on this. I love that you turn into you don't turn into to flower petals, but you know, you leave behind like a cloud of flower petals. That's just so cool.
Yeah, it's a very samurai thing, or like jutsu or something. Yeah, yeah. Like the after image sort of thing. Mm-hmm. It's very cool. I love that whole aesthetic. It's really nice.
Yeah, and again, I love the mechanic of you can do this as a reaction, which is really good.
Yeah,
but you have to meet the enemy's attack roll first. I love that so much. That's so good. So
pretty cool.
Yeah. So, I mean, not a ton more to talk about this, but great item, great theming, you know, double thumbs up for me.
Cool.
So once again, that was the Sakura Blade submitted by Avin Shill via email. If somebody wanted to submit magic items for us to talk about, Jeff, or if they had questions for us to discuss or stories for the funeral pyre, how would they get those to us?
They can send them in an email to interpartyconflict@gmail.com.
Yes. Before we get into questions, though, we have a winner this week. A whoa, winner.
Winner chicken dinner.
Yes. So we are giving away a copy of Chapel on the Cliffs by Goblin Stone. It's a great 5th edition adventure for low-level adventurers. Mm-hmm. And it's a great adventure. And we have a winner today. I'm repeated everything 5 times in there. So, Jeff. Who is our winner this week?
Our winner is our friend Dave.
Whoa, winner.
Gobble, gobble, gobble.
Yes, Dave P.
Dave P. He actually, he entered in, and I didn't realize he was in the entering.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised that more friends of ours have not entered.
Right.
Like, I mean, you know, we've got a good amount of listeners that we don't know, but then we have several listeners that are friends of ours, and it's like, you get a free adventure, just enter. And I mean, we've been perpetually kind of pretty low on entrance, just kind of, you know, scraping by, I guess. So like, just send us an email. Yeah. Well, sorry, excuse me. How would someone enter this drawing, Jeff?
They can send us an email at interpartyconflict@gmail.com with Chapel on the Cliffs in the subject line.
Yeah, it's that easy. Yeah. So whether you know us or if you don't know us,
right,
enter this drawing.
Yeah.
You'll very likely win relatively soon.
Right. I mean, we usually don't have too many people at a time, so your odds are pretty good.
Yeah, yeah.
Winner is Dave, and he also goes by Deeps, or by his full name, Deeps the Deeps Deeps Deeps.
Yep.
So.
Wait, Jeff, you're not supposed to say their full name.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, Mr. Deeps.
Yeah, so congratulations, Dave. If you don't get this within... you know, a couple days, let us know. Uh-huh. If you like it or if you don't like it, be sure to let Goblin Stone know so that they can continue to make wonderful products for everybody.
Now, I am going to be playing D&D with him tomorrow. Should I mention it or should I make him listen to this? Like, you know, it's like, I should tell him, like, you know what you should do? You should listen to that episode.
You could do that. We had, somebody who... We had a listener that like emailed me about something. They had a question or something. And so I answered it. And it was the day that it went out. I realized, he won this week. So I was like, and by the way, you should probably listen to this week's episode. anyway, so thank you, Goblin Stone. Thank you, Dave.
Yep.
Thank you, all of our other listeners who have entered or who have not entered, I guess.
And but, thanks to all of our patrons, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It will have gone out over a week ago, but we just finished recording our this month's bonus episode.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So that went a lot of fun. It went very long. Went a lot longer. I got pretty pretty energetic in there.
It's one of, it'll probably go down as one of the classics of Gabe Rants.
I mean, we can say what it is. We talked about our gaming pet peeves.
Right. So
and I've got some pet peeves.
He's got some things to say.
You believe you me. Yes.
Like I was watching the waveform of the recording, and his volume was getting progressively bigger, mm-hmm. you know, as the episode went on. So, right.
So yeah, that is a benefit of being a $5 or higher patron of ours.
Right, get access to the bonus episodes.
Yes, we also, you know, we've got stuff for $1 patrons. Mm-hmm. We've also got stuff for $10 patrons. We've got outtakes for everybody. I've got fantasy fiction I write every month for everybody. You know, all of our patrons get to read those. $5 patrons, you also get bonus episodes. You get I do like a little once or twice a month, I do like a little thing talking about how the podcast is going, how what sort of media I've been consuming, that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
It's been a bit of depressing at times because I've within the last few months I've had several pets pass away, which is very, very disappointing. But
yeah, it's part of owning pets because, you know, it's the whole humans have a longer lifespan thing.
Right, so right.
It's going to happen. But.
Right. But I try to have a lot of, you know, like, hey, here's some good podcasts you should listen to. Here's some good movies you should watch and so on. Also, I mentioned a movie that I watched very recently in the most recent one. The movie was real bad. So I won't say what movie it is. You have to become a patron to find out which movie you should not go see. Anyway, and then if you're a $10 patron, you get to take part in our monthly Patreon game. Our last Patreon game was so much fun. Mm. I had a blast doing it. And I hopefully will be able to finish out that adventure the next time we do. So I'm probably going to, by the time this goes out, I probably will have tried to contact all of our patrons about when to do that.
Cool.
So Patreon game. Also, I will write about your character mm-hmm. for our monthly fantasy fiction. So yeah, check it out at patreon.com/interpartyconflict. We've got some cool stuff on there, and you'll be helping make the show better.
Yeah.
You know. And then just a couple more things. Crit Academy. Mm-hmm. Be sure to check out Crit Academy. It's a great podcast. CritAcademy.com. CritAcademy.com. Crit Academy is a great podcast. The hosts, Justin and them, they make new and reusable content for players and DMs alike. It's a lot of fun. They're going through some like character. They're going through some Unearthed Arcana character options at the moment, and a lot of them are really, really cool. Mm. I mean, all the ones I've heard so far have been really cool, so check them out. Also, D&D Character Lab, they make characters every week, and then they pit them against each other and see whose character is better.
Right.
It's a lot of fun to listen to. Yeah. So much fun. Also, one more thing is not podcast related. A good friend of ours who is also one of our patrons, also he's just a personal friend of ours, he like comes to the games at the library and stuff, his name is Justin Williams. He recently released a rock album, and I've given it a listen, and like I'm actually surprised at how good it sounds. You know, I whenever someone that I know creates something, I always expect it to be really bad.
I don't think you're expecting it to be bad. It's just it's more that you're worried that it's going to be bad or something like that.
I guess, yeah.
Yeah, because, yeah, I get that too, where it's just like I don't want to, like, Skylar has not listen to much of the podcast uh-huh. or watch much of Friend Quest because she's like, I don't like looking at my friend's art because
sure.
because she's really critical of stuff. Mm-hmm. So she doesn't want to be too critical of something by somebody she knows.
Right.
You know,
right.
You know, unless they like beg for, criticism or
sure,
something.
Sure.
Like that.
But no, I gave this a listen. I think it's really good. Mm-hmm. So I think you guys should check it out. The band is called Dark Capricorn Rising.
Okay.
And so I'll put a link in the show notes. I'll read a quick description. I'll read the link to you, but it's relatively simple. It is go to reverbnation.com/artist/Dark Capricorn. So Dark Capricorn Rising is what it's called. I don't know if you can listen to the whole album, but you can listen to some of it at least. So I do recommend you go check that out. Again, I'll put it in the show notes. I'll probably post it on our Facebook group as well. He's a good friend of ours. He's like the nicest guy in the world.
Yeah, yeah. He's really nice, and he's a supporter of the podcast.
Very much so.
So he's a big supporter of the podcast, actually.
Yeah.
So
yeah, go check that out. Again, Dark Capricorn Rising. It's really good. So let us know what you think. If you can't I don't know if any of his contact information is on there, but if you let us know what you think, I can pass it on to him.
Yeah.
Myself. So yeah, I'd love to get some feedback on that. I'm sure he would love to hear that people are listening to his music.
Cool.
All right. You want to go ahead and get into this episode?
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
Our first question comes from LostRanger17 on Reddit. What are some tips on running a campaign based entirely around exploration?
Yeah.
This is something I've kind of been thinking about myself, just because I've been sort of toying the idea of if and when I ever do run a campaign or do some DMing. I kind of want it to be sort of exploration heavy.
Yeah.
The current idea is like a bunch of uncharted islands or something like that. I thought would be kind of neat. So like each island could be its own little adventure or something like that. So I thought that'd be kind of a neat little idea. So I guess the idea of what they're asking is, you know, like having a campaign that is less about an overarching story and more about just the exploration of a land.
Yeah. When they asked the question, I'm pretty sure they even said that it wasn't even necessarily going to have like a main villain.
Yeah. So like it's more about just like getting to know the setting, coming across different, like you could throw like in this sort of a campaign, I feel like you can kind of just throw any old pre-made adventure in there.
Yeah.
So if you like didn't want to do too much preparation that session, just like, you know, pull out a pre-made adventure, just say like, oh, you guys are exploring these mountains and you come across a cave. Inside the cave is this dungeon, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But it is one of those things where you have to be really good at coming up with stuff on the like right off the cuff.
Sure.
A lot of improvising, having several things prepared, but not too much. That whole, you know, we talked about that a lot.
I guess one thing to keep in mind is that you need to decide whether you want it to be whether you want it to be truly open world or if you just want it to seem open world.
Okay.
You probably don't want it to seem like linear. I mean, that's probably one of the goals of this is to make it feel like the players could go anywhere and do anything. If you are going to have it be truly open world, that's going to be a lot of work because you're going to have to make sure that you have a lot of stuff to draw from depending on what the players do, unless you're really good at improvising.
Sure.
Or if you are going to make it sort of like on rails, but it seems like it's open world, then that means you are narrowing the scope a little bit. You don't have to prepare quite as much, but you have to make sure that what you do have prepared, you can fit really well into what's going on. You want to make sure that like whatever the players decide is going to lead to what you have prepared.
Right.
So that you don't have to, so that it doesn't seem like you're shoehorning them into something.
Right. You want to do that well because you don't want them, you know, you don't want them to realize that any choice that they make doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you're trying to make it a linear thing, like if you're doing the whole, there's a fork in the road. If they go left, it's one thing. You want them to go left, but they go right. Just have what was to the left to the right.
Yeah.
Like that's a good thing to do if you're like, you know, worried about not having enough stuff prepared and things like that. But for like the whole of a campaign, when you're, and if it's supposed to be based on exploration, but you want to have this sort of linear progression.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just feel like if it gets noticed by the players
that, the moment one player notices it and the whole thing is kind of going to fall apart.
Yeah.
Or at least the players might start to resent that.
Right. Yeah.
I think let's try to, let's try to sort of split the discussion into two parts. First, let's give just like kind of general tips, what we've been doing, general tips on like things to keep in mind when you're doing this. Then maybe at the end, if we want to do like some ideas for stuff that you could do.
Yeah.
As a general tip, I would say that I'll say first off, I love the idea of an exploration-based campaign. That sounds so much fun, where like every session we're going somewhere, seeing what's there, maybe charting it, maybe like, you know, finding out what's there and then I don't know, seeing where to go from there.
Right.
I love this idea. Many times over the years we have said, hey guys, let's do a campaign where we're going to be like just going from place to place and, you know, new uncharted lands and so on. We've had this idea many times because it's a great idea.
Yeah.
It would be great. However, it's all in that execution. It could be very, very easy for this to turn out feeling completely aimless.
Sure.
And they mentioned that like they might not even have like a villain or something. I think that although they shouldn't necessarily know who the villain is at the beginning, I think there should be an overarching, maybe not even necessarily a villain. Mm. There should be an overarching goal.
Yeah.
If you are watching a show that is 100% episodic, where no episode leads directly into another episode, and like it can get a little stale when you feel like the end of the show is no different than the beginning of the show.
Sure.
Depending on the type of show, that can be good. Depending on the type of show, it can be bad. A show like Lost, I haven't seen a lot of Lost, but I mean, all I've heard about Lost is that it felt aimless a lot. It felt like they were constantly learning things, but then the things that they were learning didn't necessarily answer any of the questions they were asking. They just asked more questions.
Yeah.
That can be an approach, but unless you, like, if you plan for the campaign to have a definite end, you probably want to be moving towards something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it could be fun going through a campaign that is just a big sandbox. You know, we're just going to keep going until we get sick of it. But I don't think that's going to be satisfying in the long run.
Mm.
I get, you know, it could be, it could not be. But I would say, at least in the short term, the players should have a goal. Even if it's like, actually, I'll mention, Ian, this was posted on Reddit, and there were some great responses from Prozno and Werebear Esquire. And one of the things that Werebear Esquire mentioned was to make sure that the players know about like some geographic features. I think that a great goal, maybe for the first like couple adventures of the campaign, the characters have a goal of getting to that mountain over there. Here's an idea. It doesn't even have to be a mountain. It could be like a weird obelisk off in the distance or something. Something mysterious.
Mm-hmm.
I played through a bit of the Tomb of Annihilation. We didn't get very far, and then we ended up casting it aside and doing something else. But in the time that we did play, what?
Sorry, obelisk. I know about the obelisk in that adventure.
Oh, is there actually an obelisk? I don't know if we got to an obelisk. That was just an idea.
There's an obelisk I could go on.
But there's a point fairly early on, we got to like a high point where we could look out and see certain landmarks.
Mm-hmm.
And there were some weird landmarks out there. We're in the middle of a jungle, this big giant jungle continent. There's like a big rock off in the distance that's like bleeding or something. It's called like the heart of something or other.
Yeah.
There's another spot where there's like a giant shipwreck that's like suspended up in the trees or something.
Huh.
Just some weird places. It's like, I want to go there. And because of the nature of the campaign, getting there is, you know, part of the adventure. It's not just like, oh, okay, roll some dice. All right, no random encounters, you're there. It's like, that's our goal. But to get there would take a couple sessions worth of, you know, traversing,
yeah,
everything. So if the players have a specific goal, they can be like, okay, we're gonna go there. Then maybe you can structure the campaign so that once they get there, they find out some details that they realize that maybe there's some weird stuff going on, and then they're investigating the weird stuff that's going on. Mm-hmm. Maybe they get there and they find out like, oh, all of the monsters in the area are like, they all have this like symbol glowing on their forehead when the moon is out or something like that. I don't know.
Hmm.
And then the next leg of the campaign is them trying to find out what the heck that is about. Then maybe they find out it's about, oh, there's like an ancient god or something. You know, you don't want it to be completely aimless. I think giving it some sort of structure that like for the first few adventures, their goal is this. The next few adventures, their goal is this. The next few adventures, their goal is this. So that they do have something that they don't feel like they're just wasting time.
Mm-hmm.
They do have something they're moving towards. And then if something comes up that they have to put that on hold for a little bit, they know that they got to come back to it. You know, when you're playing a game like Fallout or Oblivion or whatever, you've got your main quest.
Right.
You can put it out. You can put it to the side and go on these side quests, but you do still always have that main quest. I think that a game like Skyrim without a main quest would be real bad. Now, I could be wrong. I could be wrong, because, I mean, heck, I never do the main quest in these types of games.
Yeah, that's true.
But I know it's there.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I think having it there is always nice, because you know that there is this big thing that you want to get to eventually or something like that, but you got all this other stuff you can do. But it's not like, it's not like a normal linear campaign where you're like, I have to go do this and save the world, because otherwise, like, if I don't do it soon enough, the bad guy will whatever.
Yeah.
But if it's like, all right, this is the thing we got to take care of. Like, I want to get to this because it's important, but I'm going to go check out this cave, or I'm going to go check out this other cave,
yeah,
or I'm going to go fight those bandits, or I'm going to, you know, like, and doing so, you have a good time, but then you always have that, like, All right, yeah, I feel like I've raided enough like bandit camps and gathered enough, you know, equipment and stuff to go take on that thing I was, you know, thinking about earlier.
Yeah.
You know, that could be fun. I love that like getting a vantage point thing.
Okay.
That's I'm going to write that down actually.
Sure.
I'm actually already thinking of like would be really cool to have like I've always tried to think of ways to like use something like Minecraft like as a visual aid.
Oh yeah, yeah.
For Dungeons and Dragons. So like making a map in Minecraft and like having the characters have some ability to get like a bird's eye view sort of a thing in some situations. So like maybe they get some magical item that allows them to see, or use a familiar, you know, basically.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, you send it up in the air and have a look around. But like give them something visual so like you can like pan around, like give them like a 360 view of where they're at and be like, oh yeah, what's over there? Let's we're going in that direction. What direction is that? East? Okay, let's go there.
Yeah. I can think of a couple video games where you get to a certain point and then like your character's able to like look in a telescope and then it just puts points on your map.
Yeah, yeah.
I know Final Fantasy IX does it.
Right. That became a big thing in the open world. That has become a big thing in like open world games. Mm-hmm. Assassin's Creed's go up to the tower.
Oh yeah, then, like, Zelda.
Zelda does it. Zelda did it. Breath of the Wild did it, where like it didn't put points on your map.
It just let you see the map.
It just lets you see the map. You can put your points on the map. Like you can use the scope, your scope basically to like ping a spot and it would put a point on your map wherever it is. So if you saw a mountain off in the distance, say, I want to climb that mountain, you put a point on there and then you look on your map and it actually shows you where it is on the map, even if you don't have that area cleared or whatever.
Yeah.
Which is cool. Other games, it's just like you clear an area on the map and then it shows you this is it'll put icons on the map for you just to tell you where to go basically. So I mean, something like that is kind of a good mechanic. I think going a little overboard with the icons is kind of a bad thing. Cause it's like, it's telling your player what to do.
Yeah, that's true.
It's like, it's an open world, but we're going to tell you what to do. Cause we put it on the map for you.
Yeah.
Whereas with the Breath of the Wild here's a nice, nice viewpoint. Do what you want. Mm-hmm. Like, do you see something cool? Go do it. You know, have at it. So I think that's a cool thing to do for any sort of exploration type gameplay.
Yeah. One question that I think you should ask is whether you want there to be a time constraint. If you don't, that, you know, I guess that leaves more room for the players to do what they want.
Yeah.
But it could make it easier for the game to feel kind of aimless. If it's just like, all right, well, we don't have to be anywhere. What are we going to do? Whereas if you do put a time constraint, it can make it feel a little bit more railroady, but it'll make sure that the players don't waste time. Mm-hmm. Like they don't just do something just for the heck of it. They only go and do things if like they that's definitely what they want to do.
Right. There was a video I saw recently on YouTube. Mm-hmm. It's on a channel. It's Zbashu.
Okay. I've never heard of that.
Zbashu. I don't know. Z-E-E space B-A-S-H-E-U. Okay. Or H-E-W, sorry. It's a YouTube channel. It's a guy who does like little animations where he like talks about different D&D stories. Mm-hmm. And he'll talk specifically about a spell or something like that. Like he has one that's about the Featherfall spell, but he tells like a little story about how his adventure, like how his party, you know, used Featherfall in a cool way. But he'll like sort of, and some of them he'll go into more depth of the rules and stuff. There was one for the sleep spell where like they took care of some kobolds or something with one spell. And it was great. You know, it was cool little thing. He put one up recently that talked about a style of DMing where it was a little bit more open-ended, where you have an idea in mind of like an overarching plot. And like have that available.
Yeah.
But you know, other than that, you don't really plan too much. You might have a few things, like a handful of things here and there. What made me think of this was, what was like creating the world as you're exploring it, but creating it with the help of the players.
Okay.
So like in this video, he talked about like, you know, you have your storyline that you want your players to have access to, but they don't have to do it. Mm-hmm. But then say like, you know, pick a setting that you want to be in. So like Forgotten Realms, and then, you know, ask the players where they want to go.
Sure.
And so like, okay, but it's a place that you can look up online. So you like something that's like easily like looked up on like Wikipedia or something like that. So you could be like, all right, just get a basic idea of what's there.
Mm-hmm.
And then like on the way there, you're having the players come across more or less random encounters. And during those random encounters, like you're, you know, where there's, you know, you don't have to have a, do a lot of work during those encounters. You sort of plan what's going to happen when they get there.
Sure.
I don't know. He had this neat suggestion of, you, for like for your random encounters, you have your players help you decide what's going to be on there.
Oh, okay.
So it was, you basically putting like little like putting slips of paper in a hat.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So like you as the DM put in two bad things, and then each player puts in one good thing and one bad thing. One good thing that they want, and one bad thing that they think would be cool to have like some like a challenge and a reward.
Uh huh.
Each player puts in one of each, and then for each good thing that you're putting in, you're getting another bad thing, and so you have on top of the two bad things that you put in as a DM, you have some of these, you know, you have all these bad things, one extra bad thing per player. And a good thing. And then so you draw out of that hat to like, you know, for something to and like you want to like look at them ahead of time to make sure somebody didn't put down like, oh, you find a ring of three wishes or something like
sure,
that.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
Something that's on the level on level with everything else. But you let the players help out in, you know, the creation of the world
mm-hmm.
as much as you are. And so everybody's more involved, more invested.
I really like that idea.
I think you should definitely go watch this video. Like it's fairly simple, and it's like it's nothing. Like it does involve a lot of. You have to have pretty good improv skills.
You got to have players who know what they want,
right?
I guess.
Yeah, you got to have them when they know what they want, and this particular style he's talking about, it's more specific to like. Settings that are well fleshed out already.
Yeah.
So in an exploration thing that might like, if you're exploring a new world or something or a world of your own creation, you have to basically create the entire world to every little detail first in order to do something like this. But I mean, like if you wanted to create the world with the players as you're playing the game, I think that'd be kind of interesting.
That could be really cool. If your players were like explicitly going to be helping with the world creation.
Yeah. There's that world building game.
Yeah. And yeah.
Like I've always
Dawn of Worlds, I think it's called.
I think so. And like it's like a couple pages worth of a PDF, and it's sort of neat. And like, there's a couple rules in it that I'm like, I'm a little confused on.
Yeah.
But I think it'd be neat to like play that game and then play a campaign in that world and then, you know, kind of flesh out the world with the players.
That would be really cool. Yeah.
I feel like that'd be a neat little process. It would, you know, again, it's all about the execution. But.
Sure. And sorry, quick little recap of what Dawn of Worlds is, assuming that I have that name right. It's a game where everybody sits down and as a group, you basically create the world that you're going to be playing in. But if I recall, you each take turns. You each decide one or more facets of the world, and then as you can rewrite someone else's thing that they've created. But
right.
What that means is that, like, let's say there one player says, "Okay, there's a continent right here," and then someone else says, "Oh, there's not a continent there." That means that continent got destroyed or something.
Right? Yeah. It's not you're not redoing a thing. You're
building on it.
You build upon it. So yeah.
And then like each phase of the game starts out like a huge span of time. So it's like over eons.
Right.
Then it's like over centuries. And then it's like over the last few years.
Right. Yeah. So it's about
you start getting more and more granular in there.
Yeah, exactly. So you build the physical world and then you sort of build like the natural world. Mm-hmm. And then you build like the civilizations and stuff.
Yeah.
And,
yeah. And I'll try to find a link and put that in the show notes. Mm-hmm. One thing that you mentioned that I think a lot of people probably forget about is that not all random encounters are fights.
Right. Yeah.
You said that you draw stuff out of a bag and the players can put stuff in there and it's all like one good thing, one bad thing. Especially if the entire thing is going to be exploration where I think the instinct would be to just, okay, roll for random encounters. That doesn't mean every session you're just going to be rolling for what's a fight, what's a fight,
yeah.
What's a fight. You do want some random encounters to be peaceful role-playing encounters.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe some of them are just, oh, you find something that looks cool. You know, you find a cool rock formation or something. Could be that maybe you find, you know, a hidden treasure or something like that. So especially if your campaign is going to be exploration, you want to make sure that there is a good variety of what sort of things they discover.
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise it's definitely going to start feeling stale after a while. Like, oh, another random encounter, you say, another random fight. So let's maybe start moving into ideas, and you know, we'll wrap this up pretty soon.
Sure.
I think we're getting close to the end of this episode, but let's move into ideas. And one thing that I want to say, because I was mentioning earlier about you know, try to introduce some sort of a time constraint. I think could help the game from getting to be too open ended or too stale.
Yeah,
I would say a great time constraint to put in: rival adventurers. Not necessarily like a villain, not necessarily a big bad evil guy or whatever, but another group of adventurers that whatever the player's overall goal is, whether it is to be the first ones to chart this continent or if there is something they're looking for, if there is another group of adventurers, and they don't have to be bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
It could be that you guys are on good terms, but you are both trying to do the same. You are both going for the same goal. Maybe like you're going through the thing, you run into them out of the blue, you didn't even know they were there. And then you split up, maybe on apprehensive terms, maybe at a later time, they're in danger, you save them. You're in danger, they save you. Maybe they do turn out to be the, you know, the end confrontation, or maybe you come across them all dead.
Oh.
And now you're trying to find out who killed them.
Right, yeah.
That could be not, it doesn't necessarily, that doesn't say like what is going to happen through the campaign, but it is a through line.
Mm-hmm.
If this were a TV show, you would know there are some episodes that are just the main characters exploring. Some episodes are like plot relevant episodes.
Yeah.
And then that's when the other party comes in.
Yeah. That's a cool idea where you have like this party rivalry thing going on, and like, it kind of like keeps building and building and building, and then like suddenly you find them, you stumble upon them all dead, and it's like,
yeah,
whoa. And like, yeah, you kind of like didn't like these guys, and you were kind of against them the whole time, but at the same time you're like, oh wait, I know these people.
Mm-hmm.
I know they can handle a lot. What killed them?
Or something spooky has happened to them.
Right.
Maybe you encounter them and they don't remember you.
Ooh.
Or like they're trapped in some sort of like they're trapped in a time loop or something. You know, there's lots of,
or you find their bodies, but their bodies have decayed like thousands of years.
Ooh, that's
or something.
Good. That's good.
You're like, wait a minute. Like that looks like the thing I gave that, like I handed to that guy, but
yeah,
it's like,
yeah,
it's been aged or whatever, you know, or some sort of like time monster.
Sure. Sure. I guess they didn't really, Lost Ranger 17 didn't really give any sort of details on like what the campaign was going to be about.
Sure.
I think in my mind, I've been picturing it as like, oh, there's a continent that they're going to go explore.
Mm-hmm.
Could be something bigger than a continent. Could be something smaller than a continent.
Yeah.
Have you ever, I feel like I'm opening up a big can of worms here, but have you ever read the book House of Leaves?
No.
Okay. For anybody listening, I'm going to say this, and this is law. House of Leaves is a bad book.
Oh. Uh-oh.
Very, very, very brief description of this book.
Okay.
There is a movie, a documentary that a guy made where he realizes that in his house, so like his house has some weird features to it. Eventually he notices, oh, there's a door in my house that does not open out to the other side of that wall. He opens it up and it opens out to basically an extra dimensional part of his house.
Okay.
And you're not reading a book about that, though. The book that you're reading, well, so you're not reading about that. After that, that documentary is called The Navidson Report. After that documentary was released, an old shut-in decided to write a book about it. You're not reading that book. His notes were found by this drug and sex-fueled guy in like the 90s or something like that. You're reading his like revision of the notes of this documentary.
I feel like you've mentioned this before, or not on the show, but I think this sounds
book,
somewhat familiar.
I'm going to be making some enemies here. This book is borderline unreadable. Half the book is unreadable because it is the whole book is like, it's an experience, and there are parts of the book that are just gibberish, like literally just gibberish. But there are people who insist that, oh, that's what makes the book good. And I have to say to you, good sir, if your book requires dozens of pages of gibberish to be good, your book is not good. Anyway, the core story there, the Navidson Report, I think is a great, great, interesting concept. And I haven't finished the book. I made it about halfway through the book and I was like, I cannot read this book anymore. But part of the book is like they're going into this part of the house and exploring it and trying to find out what is this, what is in here, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I would love to play a campaign where you are in some sort of like a building that, or just I'll just say a campaign where the whole campaign is you're exploring a building.
Mm.
I like that idea. Also, I would like it even more if it was like, oh, this building could not exist. Like physically does not, could not spatially exist in the way that it is. And just the thought of like, this is a normal, mundane place, but something about it just cannot be.
Hmm.
You know, I really like that idea. I would love to play a campaign that was not necessarily a building, but I've thought of like maybe trying to run an adventure where the players were just trapped in a maze of some sort.
Mm-hmm. What's the dungeon?
The world's largest dungeon?
World's largest dungeon, where it's a campaign set completely in a dungeon?
Yes.
Yeah.
The cantrip, the hosts on the cantrip mentioned that often.
Oh, okay.
I guess they played through that and they really, really liked that.
They did? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, because...
I have a copy because my friend Mike gave me, or he let me borrow his copy indefinitely. Sure. I don't know if I'm going to read it anytime soon, but...
It's like that's that was such a neat idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it's just like you just spend an entire campaign inside of a dungeon.
Yeah. So I mean, just a campaign where like the potential play area is limited, I think, is really cool because then you can really delve into what is there. If it is just an island, then to an extent it is limited. Even if the players are able to constantly find new stuff, or if the players are able to add to it, I don't know if that's one thing I really stressed earlier is like. Try and let the players be as big of a part of this as possible. Not necessarily as part of like the plot or anything, but like if they can give you ideas for things that they want to encounter, that's a good idea. But if the area the campaign is going to be taking place in is limited in some way, then that can make you really feel like this is our area. If it's just like, okay, explore the world.
Right.
That kind of feels, it is so big that you're kind of, a lot of it's just lost.
So yeah, keep I mean, only put as much space as you're really willing to, you know, to work with, I guess. But like, yeah, like I feel like you're putting some sort of cap on the world.
Yeah, make sure that there are boundaries. Those boundaries can be very far away.
Right.
But as long as the players know we're exploring this island, we're exploring this continent, we're exploring this city, this building.
Let's go to space.
I guess. Yeah. So I mean, I guess that was more general tips. Can you think of any more like suggestions? One thing, I actually have the page open right now. Werebear Esquire recommended having magic work differently in whatever area the players are exploring.
Sure.
If it's like an island, that could be really cool. That could also be a reason why the players are there. They got there via magical means and then found out, oh, we can't teleport out of here.
Right, yeah. Something's weird with the magic or something.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Star Trek Voyager. Is the whole series is the characters are on ship. They get sucked through a wormhole or whatever. I guess Farscape is kind of the same thing. They get sent to a random off on the other side of the galaxy in Voyager. They know where they are in relation to Earth.
Yeah.
But it's going to take them like 70 years to get back.
Right.
Unless they can find another wormhole or something.
Yeah.
So the whole series is them like, well, we can self-sustain, but we're trying to get home. You know, what stuff are we going to find on our quest to get home?
Yeah.
You know.
In Voyager, like, you know, they get to points where like they come across different civilizations. Some of them are, you know, attacking them. Some of them are helping them out.
Yeah.
You know, in a lot of cases, like they have to like restock on some sort of resource. So they have to like find a place to find that. And then some, you know, adventure ensues. So like having the players like adding not just exploration, but like survival stuff.
Yeah.
Like if this is just about exploring a world, you know, have there be survival, you know, mechanics to the game so that they like they have more reason than just like, oh, I want to go check that out. It's sure. like, I want to go check that out because we need food. And that looks like a place that might have food.
Yeah, especially at first.
Yeah.
As the campaign goes on, I mean, in games where survival is a main thing, eventually you reach a point where you've got so many resources that it's not necessarily an issue. You might want that to be the case. You might not. But yeah. especially at first, you want to make sure that survival is a concern.
Right. In that... I still can't remember the name. I just looked up. But in that YouTube channel I mentioned earlier, there was one. He talked about the Goodberry spell.
Okay.
Where like in a survival adventure, like that spell kind of just like,
it's the bane of the DM's existence.
Right. It's just like, oh, okay. Like, you know, like a, what is it? It's like a first level spell, or is it a
I think it's a first level spell.
It's a first level spell that, you know, like lets you, like you can make 10 berries or whatever that sustain a person for an entire day.
And apparently there was a sage ruling that if you're a cleric with the healing domain or whatever, mm-hmm. each berry can give you like 10 hit points.
I think it's...
it's ridiculous.
I don't know if it's...
because you can add stuff to it. Right. Each one counts as a casting of a spell for purposes of like stuff that adds to your healing.
Yeah, like that, like the life domain or something like
yeah,
that.
Life, can, yeah,
that,
yeah.
Like add, I think it adds their level... to they adds their level to any like healing spell or something like that.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, you're right. Where like Goodberry can actually be like tiny, like you know, they're not huge heals, but they're like
they're, you know, I mean, it adds up.
It adds for up. A first level right, spell. Yeah, it's a lot of healing as for a first level spell.
Right. Because I was complaining about the healing spirit spell and about how like no other healing spell comes close to its potential, and people are like, well, Goodberry's first level and it's basically just as bad. It's like, oh. That doesn't make healing spirit better. It just means both of them are bad. Right. Anyway.
In that same video, he suggested like, you know, the spell component.
Yeah.
Is it's a piece of mistletoe.
Okay.
Which mistletoe isn't like super hard to find.
But it could be.
Or they just have the component pouch, which means that they don't have to worry about that. Mm. But you just, you know, you can just rule that it needs, that it consumes the thing.
Yeah, I mean, the spell component pouch is kind of it's a very much a hand-wavy item.
Yeah.
There should always be a possible scenario where you stop hand-waving that.
Yeah.
You know, I could very easily see situations calling for the DM being like, well, no, you don't have that component anymore because you haven't been able to restock it.
Right, yeah. So like in this scenario where you're, you know, exploring, you're not reaching civilization on a regular basis. You mm-hmm. don't have a shop that you go to after right. between each adventure. So, yeah, I would rule that like, you know, after so long, your character will like that component pouch will start to run dry
mm-hmm.
or like even the stuff that's not consumed. Some of that stuff's going to go bad or something
sure,
like that,
sure.
you know,
and
a lot of times it asks for like a fresh whatever or a rotten whatever. It might it's specific to, you know, like it might have to be like a living thing or a dead thing.
Yeah, there are some that are like a living worm or whatever. It definitely applies to this, but just a general tip for this sort of thing. Make sure that the players know, like at the beginning of the campaign, tell them this is the kind of campaign I'm going to be running with something like the spell component pouch. Tell them at the very beginning, if you are away from civilization for long enough, eventually this isn't going to, you know, you're not going to be able to do this anymore. You're not going to be able to do that and so on. Because mm-hmm. like I said, there's a lot of stuff that gets hand waved like spell components.
Yeah.
And because this is definitely a noteworthy situation to stop hand waving stuff, but don't spring it on your players. Say early on, hey, this is probably going to happen eventually
mm-hmm.
before it becomes an issue so that the players don't feel like you're cheating them or you're being vindictive or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, so I suppose we could keep going on with more ideas, but I think we've mainly given a whole bunch of general tips for running sure. an exploration campaign.
Yeah.
Again, I think this is a great idea.
Yeah, this is a really fun concept for D&D.
Yeah, like we individually, and I'm sure like when we were in groups together, like we've wanted to do stuff like this for a long time, but it is easier said than done.
Yeah.
So, you know, good luck. If any of you do an adventure campaign like this, we would love to hear about it.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Well, I think that'll do it for that question today. We're going to move on to our social media questions. And I will say the social media question that we had last week, we've only gotten one response to, which, to be fair, it was a bit of a, like, I was not expecting many responses to
sure.
it. In fact, I didn't have a response to it.
Yeah, I didn't.
I don't think you did either. But our question from last week was, have you ever played out a character's afterlife? And if so, what was it like? The only response we got was on Facebook from Adam B. He said, yes, we played my gladiator's journey. So his gladiator was a fighter battle master. His journey to his family home and reuniting with his wife and child. It was very emotional, and we achieved a completely silent table. This was after a year of gaming together and his backstory being revealed just before his death.
Oh.
So, I mean, that's basically cool. what I was asking for. That's pretty cool.
We had, it wasn't exactly that, but we had something in the Age of Worms campaign where it was Steve's character and like
Shadow and Silverbones.
Right. Yeah. Had like a moment where he like spoke with his like dead sister or something like that.
Yeah. So it wasn't his death, but it was he did, his character had died, his character's sister had died before the campaign, and he got to like reunite with her briefly.
Right. Yeah. To like have a moment to speak with her or something like that. Yeah. So like, you know, so it was not the same thing, but like
close,
similar tone.
I won't say which character it is because I don't want to spoil it. But at the end of the Adventure Zone, their like first arc, which was a couple years long. Griffin, the DM, he's like asking, you know, like this character, what does this character do after, basically after the campaign is over? What does your character do? What does your character do? But then for this third character, again, I'm not going to say who it is. Instead of saying, what does your character do? He asks, how does your character die?
Mm.
And I think it was a very, very like touching moment to find out like what this character's final days were like. And then they did briefly role play what that character's afterlife was like. I'm like, oh my goodness. It was one of the best moments of the campaign. So not that I would recommend anybody jump right to there.
Right.
But if you are listening to the Adventure Zone, hearing what all these characters do, the whole journey that they have from the beginning of the campaign to the end, such an epic tale. And then to find out what that one character's afterlife is like and how, you know, how their eternity is going to be, it's really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a rare moment in gaming, I feel, but when it happens, I feel like it's like in Adam B's example, that's really, really cool.
Yeah.
So let this be a tip to all of you. Try to use this in your games.
Sure.
Yeah, because like if a character dies and that player has to just make a new character, how much better would it be to, you know, role play out what happens to their character
in
the afterlife, and then you can get just a little bit, it'll let that player, you know, say goodbye to that character.
It's a good send off. Gives a little bit more closure. You know, it's not such an abrupt like, oh, well, that's the end of that guy.
Oh, I rolled a natural one. All right. Well, I was making, you know, scratch out the name and write a different name.
Right.
On it.
Write Junior on the.
right. Yeah. It's something that I think could really enrich a game.
Yeah, for sure.
So that was the only response we got for that one. Mm-hmm. You know, it's going to happen sometimes, I guess.
Yeah.
And then this week's social media discussion question is probably one that's going to get some more answers because this is a lot simpler of a question.
Sure.
Theater of the mind versus minis on a grid.
Oh.
Which do you prefer for combat and why?
Oh.
So, I mean, obviously in combat, not necessarily in like role playing, you're not going to be moving your characters on a grid. But in combat, which do you prefer, Jeff?
I prefer grid. Okay. I just because the rules are set out in such a specific way that needs a grid.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like if you just go straight theater mind, like I don't want to resent the DM for not remembering the placements of stuff.
Sure.
Like,
or if the DM just has a different image of whatever, where everything is than you do.
Exactly. So like if like, you know, because the DM might describe it in a way and my brain might see it in one way. So like maybe, or like I might mishear them or maybe they misspoke.
Yeah.
You know, so like it's like a game of telephone. You're not exactly sure everybody's got the same message.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, having the grid, you know, everybody's getting in the same boat, has the same message. So you're not going to say like, if Jay listens to this, I hope he doesn't mind us bringing it up multiple times.
Yeah.
But the thing where he's like building the device to like pull a lever or something.
That happened in our Patreon game.
Did it?
Sort of. I mean, we got to basically the same moment, and I think it was Steve actually. So he didn't take that long. He only took like a minute or two, but he thought that it was like some sort of a switch for something. So he was like describing what he was going to do to try and figure out what this thing was.
So
anyway, go on.
But yeah, like, you know, that's sort of different than dealing with combat.
Sure. But it was a misunderstanding based on just something that the players weren't seeing it the way that I saw it.
Right. So having the grid, like, everybody knows where everybody is. So like, if I say like, I want to do this, and then the DM stares blankly at you and is like, you can't do that. You're behind the door.
Right.
No, the guy's on the other side of the door. You were just looking through a crack.
Yeah.
Like, oh, okay. I'm sorry. I thought we were in the room with them. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, or I thought I was 20 feet closer to them than that. Like, no, right, you guys are like 120 feet away. Oh, okay. I misheard that. You know, that doesn't happen when there's a grid. Like, you know,
I do prefer using a grid. I have come to appreciate Theater of the Mind because it's faster.
Yeah.
It's easier at the time. Like, if you prep, then grid is easier, but it's faster. It's easier. It's easier to get people that have never played the game involved, and like, you don't bog things down. However, anything tactical, right out the window. And then also, I feel like it makes a lot of character options either meaningless or less or more powerful. Like, area attacks is basically just, it's up to the DM's whim of whether an area attack is going to hit all the enemies, some of the enemies,
right,
enemies on the player.
Yeah.
Who knows?
It's just another one of those things where, like, the rules are very specific on how I am able to play as a player.
Yeah.
So that if the DM could just on a whim decide, no, they were standing too far apart for you to do that. Like, I was like, okay, well, you know, I'm following the rules. Why aren't you?
Yeah.
You know, like, it's like, you know, be like, it's hard to be consistent when there's not something solid to look at.
Sure.
So I do prefer grid in most cases, like, but yeah, you're right. It does slow things down because, like, especially if you're doing, like, if you don't have everything prepared, like, and then, like, drawing out a thing on a grid, on a mat.
I hate having to draw everything out. It's the worst.
It's rough. I feel like, oh man, I saw some, like, Kickstarter thing for somebody who's making, like, cool looking miniature style, like, they're like interchangeable, like, grid, like, dungeon building miniatures and stuff. I'm sure they're gonna cost like a freaking fortune or something.
I know.
Miniatures. I feel like I want to get into more into miniature stuff. Like, I still haven't, like, even assembled and painted, like, half of my Warhammer army.
I got a painting kit for Christmas, and I still haven't even opened the thing up. I would love to. I just haven't had the time. I've been so busy.
Right, yeah. So, yeah. Theater of Mind is great for, definitely use it for, you know, describing things. But, like, as far as combat goes, I feel like you really need the grid.
Yeah. And I mean, if you're a player that is very, very creative and imaginative, Theater of the Mind can be awesome. Justin on Crit Academy has talked about how he feels constrained when he's on a grid because he's like, this is what's there. There isn't any more because it's right there.
Yeah.
I personally don't feel that way, but I could definitely see why somebody does.
Right, yeah.
So if you are imaginative and, like, you can picture the room around you, that's awesome. That's the best way to play. But in general, like, I find that not all players are that imaginative. Also, I really like the tactical aspect of D&D.
So yeah.
I prefer what facilitates the tactics.
Yeah.
So anyway, let us know what you think about that one. Although, as is always the case, by the time this episode has come out, the time to answer the question has long since passed. But anyway, just always check our Facebook and Twitter and Reddit to see what questions come out and let us know your thoughts. So I think that will do it for questions for today. We have a very short funeral pyre for us today. So let us sit back. Let us take a deep breath. Let's remember the adventurers who have gone before us and charted this great unknown land that is life. And let's toss another log onto the funeral pyre.
Should be one that's just rolled a one.
I mean, we've gotten a couple.
Well, we've gotten a few that are like that. Yeah. But like just the phrase, rolled a one. That's it.
Sure. So this one was submitted by Space Ape on Reddit.
Space Ape.
Pretty good name. Strahd von Zarovich, the villain of the Ravenloft campaign setting, charmed Axel and told him to go upstairs and wait for him in his bedroom.
Ooh.
Next time we saw him, he was a vampire.
Ah.
So that's it. Yeah. You know, pretty succinct.
I guess story technically right there. Dead, but more undead.
Yeah. You know, probably not a player character anymore.
Sure.
So anyway, let's raise a glass.
Should be though.
You should. Well, that I've got thoughts on that.
Sure.
So let's raise a glass in memory of Axel, who should know not to go places with strangers.
Clink.
All right. To submit questions for us to discuss, items for the Dragon's Hoard, or stories for the Funeral Pyre, please email us at interpartyconflict@gmail.com. For show notes, links to media mentioned on the show, and running lists of questions and magic items, go to interpartyconflict.com. Join the discussion on social media. Find us on Facebook, facebook.com/interpartyconflict, or our subreddit at reddit.com/r/interpartyconflict, or on Twitter, @InPartyConflict, for our weekly social media questions. Your answers might end up on the show. Find us on iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, YouTube, anywhere you download podcasts. Please rate, review, subscribe, or just tell a friend. If you'd like to support the show, check out the rewards at patreon.com/interpartyconflict. There's a few different tiers, so anything you can spare, even a dollar a month, would go towards making the show better, and you'll get bonus content for it. Jeff, tell us about FriendQuest.
FriendQuest is a YouTube channel where we play video games and sometimes stream arcade games.
Yes, we recently just streamed a bunch of arcade games. It's funny because as we record this, we have not yet done that. That's tomorrow. But
so you know, if it's for some reason it hasn't happened, oops a daisy.
Yes.
But
hopefully it'll be up there on YouTube for anybody to go watch
right.
At any time.
Yep.
Oh gosh, that zinger I said sure was good.
And remember that thing that happened? That
oh, when we're so playing fun. That game, yeah. Yeah. So speaking of arcade games, I recently started a little side project, the Arcade Memories podcast. Now that we've finished the stream, wink, wink, I'm going to be getting the next episode of that out pretty soon. So
cool.
I'm really excited about that. So arcadememoriespodcast@gmail.com. If you have any stories you'd like to submit for a future episode, find me on, I'm on iTunes and SoundCloud, you know, all that. Anyway, it's a lot of fun. I hope you guys like that too. Also head over to bit.ly/interpartyconflict to take a short survey about our show, what you like, what you don't like, etc. And just for taking it, you'll get 2 free printable board games courtesy of Mary and Tom over at hollandspiel.com. And our music is made by Boxcat Games from Nameless the Hackers RPG. So Jeff, until next time,
boldly go where no adventurer has gone before.
Ooh, that's a good one.
All right, bye everybody.